Hey Potters, welcome to episode 240 of Cosplay Podcast for all things cosplay. Woohoo!
You
We're
did that.
At 250.
You did that just to annoy me.
No. I would have said it backwards if I wanted to annoy you. Said, you know, welcome to Cosplay Podcast for all things cosplay. This is episode 240.
Sure.
At least I said it in order.
Sure.
So I was being nice.
Oh, goodness. But it's good to know, though, is that that episode 250 will be next season. We really only have like 4 or 5 episodes left because it's almost October.
Yay!
It's coming up so stinking quickly. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, I saw the Halloween and Thanksgiving gear in the stores, the retail stores now.
Yeah. Well, Christmas crap's already been up, but the Halloween stuff is great. Like, Target has a $40 life-size golden skeleton that I desperately want.
They did finally move out all of the back-to-school stuff.
Yeah, thank goodness. Yay! All the Halloween and fall stuff. Yay! The best.
I don't know how well the Halloween stuff is going to sell this year. I know that plenty of people will decorate. I don't know how many people are actually going to go out trick-or-treating.
I have a feeling it's people have... There's no nice way of saying this. People are so tired and bored of the pandemic that they're just going to do it anyway, screw the consequences. So I think that's what's going to end up happening, which is unfortunate because that means in order for me to avoid all that, I can't technically decorate, which sucks. It is what it is.
Well, speaking of Halloween costumes and cosplay, why don't we get into our cosplay updates?
Sure. Do you want to start like you usually traditionally do?
I actually do not have any updates this time around for reasons I cannot talk about publicly. Needless to say, I did film a fairly lengthy amount of footage for a tutorial that you guys will see later in the episode, and my hot glue gun smoked, so at least I did my duty of nearly setting things on fire.
That's cosplay stuff. You made a tutorial for us.
I did. You guys will be seeing that later this episode.
So mostly this is going to be the Val cosplay updates, because Val has actually been working on cosplay. Praise the universe, I'm actually doing something cosplay related. Holy schnickerdoodles. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to transition over to my Instagram page, because this is the easiest way for me to show stuff, because everything's on a dress form. I cannot move my dress form. It's kind of stuck in one position. Not because I want it to be there, but because if I try to move it, it will hurt me. I don't need it to hurt me right now. So we're going to go over to my Instagram page. I know I mentioned this previously, was that I went to one of those make your own pattern websites and you just click and you print it. Put it all together yourself, slap it on a dress form, and make magic happen. And that's exactly what I did, was I created my own pattern for a costume that I had in mind for a while. And I figured this would be a good opportunity to give this pattern thing a shot, because we all know how much I hate patterns. Commercial patterns are evil. I don't like them. Amber loves them. I hate them. So it was kind of nice to have a pattern that was actually my size, and for the most part, it worked really, really well. So I went ahead and went full steam and made a mock-up. I've got the lining done with this sucker, and I posted it, and I got some really good feedback on it. I ended up designing a almost Wah Lolita style outfit, which I'm sure the Lolita people are going to look at it and pick it apart. I don't care. This is not meant for me to get into the Lolita community. I just wanted something fun and cute. Let me have my fun and cute thing. So I made it a cute little wrap style in the front, so that means it zips up in the back. It's also got a high waist inset, which made it even more fun when it comes to lining it, because then I had to piece it very funky-like. And being me, I put in a bunch of applique pieces already, because everything has to have applique on it. Of course it does. But right now, I've got it pretty much all constructed, which is great. I still have a lot of design elements that I need to put onto it, and most of the lining is set in there, but it's not officially seamed up because I gotta get all the rest of the applique going. I've got some spots and stuff going on. I don't want to say exactly what this is yet until it's done, but I think when it's done, it'll become very apparent as to what I'm trying to replicate. But yeah, it ended up turning out pretty darn well, except for photographing the fabric. For some reason, the fabric is coming up much bluer in the light because it's in person. This is really green. It's a lovely, lovely green. The lighter fabric is aloe. I don't know what the darker green fabric is. I got to figure out how to photograph this sucker correctly because it's too blue on my screen and it kind of makes me cranky at how blue it is because that's not normal. But for the most part, I'm really happy with how it turned out. I'm surprised at how accurate the sizing of that print your own pattern thing worked. And I'm gonna try out a different pattern website that I was recommended to see what the differences are. That one has a much higher price range, but I'm told that the quality is better. So I think maybe what I end up doing is reviewing that one, trying out a couple of different websites, and maybe doing like a comparison for a future episode, since that seems to be the route that more people are taking. Because I've also noticed that McCall's is putting out a bunch of their patterns online now, so you can actually click to print their stuff. You do get it in their normal size range, though, just FYI. So it's like their 2, 4, 6, 8, blah, blah, blah. You can't get it custom to your size. And it's still full price. You don't get it cheaper for printing it at home, which seems like a really bad
And
call.
this is not Joanne's sale price, $1.99. I'm
No.
guessing this is the $15.95 to $21.95.
Something like that. They have a couple of very rare sales. Like they have one right now where I saw a couple patterns are like $3.99 or $4.99, which is great. But I'm still also like, well, if I'm spending $15.99 on a pattern, I will wait for it to come in the mail. I don't want to have to buy it and then put it together myself at the same price. That just, that doesn't sit with me very well because you, as the consumer, are having to put more work into it to put the pattern together.
Do they charge you full shipping on that too?
Probably.
Because that's even worse. That's, what do they call it? Insult on top of injury.
Injury,
When you
yeah.
have to pay a lot of shipping on top of the tiny little envelopes that are like this big that they sent you.
Yeah, I would not be surprised. I didn't look very much further than that because I saw something and I was like, I'm curious to see what the prices are between the two. And I was like, there is no price difference. And you figure with digital, it'll at least be a little bit cheaper. Because McCall's ain't printing it. So it just feels like a little bit of a ripoff there. But neither here nor there. I am planning to go look at a couple other websites that people recommended to me just to kind of try them out, see how well it is, see if they work, and probably even throw together a review for that just for Cospod because since that seems to be the method that people are going to. I mean, 245 for this really nice pattern that I made, and it worked out really darn well, and it fits me. I'd be more than willing to pay that again for another custom piece, absolutely.
That's the most important thing is that it fits.
It fits. It fits. Wonky seam allowances aside, it fits.
Well, even with commercial patterns, those are difficult to fit as is,
Oh, yeah.
regardless of any sort of custom fitting that you try and get them to do. So.
So this was nice and it was different because I didn't have to sit and draft something for 5 hours and just kind of pinning and tucking. It was just there and the mock-up worked and okay, let's just do it. So yeah, this will be the next fun project and I'll post more as it gets done. I have a zipper kit that just came in the other day. It's one of those make your own zippers where they give you like 10 yards of zippers and you can actually put in your attachments.
Oh. When
Yeah.
you said that, I thought it was like make from scratch, like attaching teeth to
Oh.
the fabric. And I was like,
Hell no.
whoa, that's ambitious.
I ain't doing that. This is not.
That's like make your
No.
own fabric where they hand you strands of silk and you have to weave the fabric yourself.
Hey, I've done that before. I don't want to do that again.
Yes, I know. That's why I would have been very surprised if you had.
No. This is like a 10-yard zipper that's been pre-made. They just give you the zipper itself, and it's like, which one do you want to attach to it? And you can cut it to length. Because I needed something that was like 28 inches in green, and it didn't exist, and I was like, screw this, I'll just buy the zipper back.
Pretty much.
So that'll be entertaining. I'm sure I'll mess up a couple times, but that's okay. Part of the process. Yeah, that's what I got for cosplay updates. It's been nice to actually start sewing something again. The petticoat is next. Lord help me.
I have to go to Joanne's to get some Play-Doh
Ooh.
before I do my next project. I actually went back because I still want to recast that quartz crystal, and I'm saving the last of my easy cast for it because I want to do one good cast.
Just
And
one.
I went, all I want's one. All I need's one. I went back and read up on two-part mold making. And I was trying to figure out what am I doing wrong? That all of mine just something goes wrong with them. Something different every time. And I realized that the way I've been making two-part molds is that I pour in a flat base first before I set my piece down, which is all fine and good. It's just a little more difficult to align the edges perfectly because there's no way to do registration keys that way unless you punch them in at precisely the right time, because otherwise the thing dries before you can do anything to it. And drilling into it at that point will shatter it. So I went and when I did my reading, I found that people are using non-dry clay. And you put that at the bottom first, then you cast. Then you remove all of the non-dry clay and you cast the other half. And that way you can do registration keys. So that's why I need play.
Curious to see how that will work. I haven't tried it with Play-Doh before.
And it doesn't have to be Play-Doh, it just has to be something that does not dry.
I would probably go with an artist clay then, just for safety, because Play-Doh is just so mushy. And
Yes.
the problem I'm thinking of is that if you want even just even the remotest tiny little bit of detail, it ain't gonna keep.
This doesn't have any detail. All of the facets are flat.
Okay, I don't know. I just
If I had my crystal next to me, I'd pull it out and show you, but it's on my table over there.
just makes me twitchy. I'm like, I don't think the Play-Doh's gonna work. But like Da Vinci clay would be more than perfect for that, because it'll never harden.
It depends on how much they want for it, because even for that tiny amount, I think it was 8 ounces total of easy cast resin, 4 ounces, 4 ounces. It was still $15. That's not very many castings. So I'm afraid to ask how much they're going to charge for their clay. I did want to say kudos to Joann's, though, because they have started carrying the big foam rolls again.
Yay! I guess they probably got enough complaints.
I'm hoping that the pressure campaign helped.
Those are very helpful rolls, I'm not gonna lie. I still have like a
Yes.
roll of it in the closet.
It's not always convenient to have to go to TNT Cosplay Supply, which nothing against them. Great company. I've bought some of their product. Just sometimes if I want to work on it right then and there, it's so much easier to just go over to my local store and physically pick up a roll than it is to order it from them because they're a decent distance from where I live to actually like go to the store and pick it up. So it's like having a shipping fee. It's basically the gas fee it takes to go all the way down there and come all the way back. We need another location on this side of the Metroplex, please.
Good luck with that.
Yeah, I know. Shall we move on to today's
Yeah,
topic?
I'm ready to go whenever you are.
Awesome. Well, like I said earlier, I did film a tutorial for you guys on how to make a badge holder, by which I mean a nifty little pocket that you can use to hold your badge, protect it, keep it nice and lovely. You can use it for multiple conventions. It doesn't have to be just for one badge. And that way you can hold on to them as keepsakes for as long as you want. So hopefully you guys enjoy this. Here we go. What I have to show you guys today is how to make a badge holder, a little fabric container or an envelope, if you will.
that can be used to hold the badges that you get at conventions, which, as we know, can be any number of sizes. Each convention has its own index card-sized badge, or it can be almost booklet-sized badge, or any number of things. I think if you make it a general size, you'll be able to fit most of the badges that you need inside of it. So, let's go. First thing that you will need, obviously, is some fabric, and I have some basic bias strips that I've cut for this demonstration. Obviously, you don't have to use bias strips that are this thick. This is about an inch or so in width. You can use thinner ones if you like, you can use thicker ones if you like. But the idea behind this is to take these and to form a square or rectangle if you prefer. It's whichever you like so, and then your badge will fit in here. Obviously, if you want it smaller, then you can cut the strips thinner so that they all match. The next thing you'll need is a piece of backing fabric, and you'll cut that after you've determined how large you want your badge holder to be, because you're going to cut another single piece of fabric that is the size of your badge holder, one single piece of cloth. And the last thing that you're going to need, vinyl. Clear vinyl looks a little something like this, because you want conventions to be able to read your badge through it. Once you have figured out the size of your badge holder, yay big, then you will cut your piece of clear vinyl to that dimension. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to basically miter all four of these strips into a square or a rectangle, whichever you've chosen. First things first, because I want to mark on these, and I don't want to mark on the outside, I want to mark on the wrong side, the side that's not going to show, I actually need to fold these backwards first. So you can see the matte satin side is the inside, and the shiny satin side is the outside that I want to show. So I'm going to fold these with matte side showing out. And the fold is going to be on the outside of my square. Like this. Fold is right here, fold is outside. So the way I want these to be joined is like this, at a 90 degree angle, to make a square or rectangle shape. So I want it to end up like this. First, I'm going to lay the strip across like this to form a 90 degree angle, and I'm going to mark this bottom line right here with a pencil. The second step I'm going to do is, now that I've got this marking right here across the bottom, since I know that it's going to eventually be assembled like this, with the corner here on the inside, what I'm going to do is to draw a line from the corner here to the inside of where I want the corner to be. Top corner to inside corner. So the line will go diagonally. You can see there, I've got a bit of a triangle shape going on. This bottom line is not going to matter at the end. This can go away. The line you really want is this diagonal right here, because that's going to become your stitching line. And what you want to do for the final step here before you sew it is you need to mirror that line. That same line needs to be diagonal on this side as well. There will be two stitching lines. So now I can take my two bias strips. You only have to mark one of the strips. Right sides together, just like you would in standard sewing. And now I'm going to stitch those two lines right there. And then I'm going to take this process and I'm going to repeat it with the other set. Ultimately, I'm going to end up with two 90 degree strips that look like this. I'm going to repeat that same process by taking one side of my little L shape, folding it backwards, and then do the same thing with your other L shape. So you're doing the same step that you did with the two separate strips with your two L's, so that in the end, once you've done that, then all four of these will be sewn together in this nice pretty miter shape. I have my finished square here. The next step, once you have your nice pretty finished square, it's going to be to apply the vinyl. And you can see that I've got my hot glue gun out here. You're saying, Amber, why do you have a hot glue gun when you're dealing with fabric? This is one of the few times I'm going to tell you it's okay to use a hot glue gun with fabric. And the reason for that is because vinyl is a non-woven material. That means anytime that you punch holes in this, those holes are permanent. They will not come out. So if I were to take a sewing machine and run it across the edges of this, I'm going to destroy the structure of the vinyl, and it's going to become easier to simply tear it. And because I don't want a bunch of holes that make it easy to tear, this is that one time I'm going to tell you, use a hot glue gun for this. You have a couple of different options on how you would like to assemble. The vinyl is going to have to go inside like this. You can see I'm kind of tucking that up inside. So what I would do is lay this over my square like this, so that you know the vinyl has to be just smaller than the finished product of your square. And so you need to take some sort of marker, pen, something where it's visible on the vinyl. It won't be visible in the final product. Then just trace around so that you can cut your vinyl to the correct shape. So what you would do with this, you have the choice. You can either glue it from the front, which is the top side, or the back, which is this side. And you'll take your hot glue and just apply it and press down. The reason I'm not applying the glue right now is because I wanted to explain to you the two ways that you can assemble your little pocket. Remember I told you to grab a piece of backing fabric? You can either take this, and then once your square of vinyl has been glued down and applied, you can stitch this three sides, not four sides, just three. You don't stitch any part of the top. You need to have an opening to put your badge inside. So what you'll want to do if you use this method is choose which side of the square is your top. I'm going to fold that edge over like this so that it has a nice finished edge when I stitch down. And I would stitch one, two, three sides. And that would be my finished pocket. The other thing that you can do with this, your fabric, and cut it the same size that you did your vinyl. And just like the first method, you still fold over one edge because you still want it to have a nice finished edge, right? But instead of doing right sides together and stitching three edges down, you want the right side out and facing you. So there's my folded edge at the top. And then I'm gonna tuck this in along with the vinyl. I've got my folded edge at the top, and all of the other edges are self-contained. So what you end up having is this little pocket right here. And this is where you stick your badge. Now, if you don't want your folded edge to show through the vinyl window, then you can always double fold your edge like that so that you have a nice finished edge. You'll want to stitch this edge down first, then take this piece and tuck it inside, and then go ahead and secure this. So that way you maintain your nice finished edges around on the pocket, and then you still have your backing fabric, and then you slip your badge right inside there. So you've got your frame here that you've assembled. If yours is like mine and you don't have a particular front and back, both sides are the same, you choose which one is the front and which one is the back. But it's very important that you know which is which. So as long as you pick one, you're good. I'm going to have the front side of the badge holder, which is the side that will face out towards people when I am wearing it, facing up. I'm going to take my nice clear piece of vinyl here. I'm going to slide it inside my frame. You have your frame, you have your piece of vinyl inside the frame, front side up. What I'm going to do is I'm going to lift the flap of this front edge here at the top. I'm going to lift that flap up, and this is where I'm going to put the adhesive. And you can actually see the back edge of the bias tape through the vinyl because I'm holding the front. So here's the back edge. You can use that as a guide as to where to put your adhesive. And I'm going to put that on the top side like this. And then very carefully press down. But I'm going to rotate, and I'm going to do the exact same thing on all four sides. Can see this is now secured with the top flap. I can't lift the top flap up anymore. It is adhered down, which is what you want. What I'm going to do next is flip it over so that the back side of the frame. Back side is now facing up. I'm going to do very similarly to what I did with the clear vinyl, but this time I'm going to do it with my backing piece, my fabric backing. I'm going to fold down one edge here. Ideally, you would stitch this down, fold it over here, and then I'm going to take this piece of fabric likewise and tuck it into my frame. Same process, lifting up that flap. I'm gonna rotate this just a bit for ease of use. Put my adhesive down. I am actually running out of hot glue. It's one of the few things, potters, that you cannot have enough of in life is hot glue. So I've got this side secured. So I'm going to rotate around like so. Lift up that top flap there. Now that I've got all of these sides adhered with my hot glue, there is one last thing I'm going to do with this, and that is to put an attachment on it. You see my little split ring that I'm going to use? I'm going to take that and put it right here at the center of the top edge, which is the side where I'm going to attach the lanyard, like this. So I'm going to put the ring at the top of my frame. Attach the ring, I'm going to put the glue over it. So I'm going back and forth, side to side. And it is actually so hot it is smoking, and since I am standing right underneath my fire alarm, I am very much hoping that the cosplay gods are kind to me and do not make my fire alarm go off while I am doing this. This is how Amber do. We don't do things the way that most people would normally. We set off things like smoke alarms while we are making cosplay. So now we have a finished badge pocket. As an example, pocket edge right here. You can see I can pull that up and open. I'm going to slide this right inside like that. And there you have it. You can actually see the badge through it. It's nice and protected with the clear vinyl. And then you have the split ring on top where I can hook. There we go. And then you would wear it just like this. So there you have it. There is your lanyard pocket.
Hopefully that was helpful for you. I know it doesn't necessarily account for the multitude of different badges that conventions have now. I realized after I made that tutorial that like my Acon badges will fit, my Dallas Costumers Guild will fit, my Fan Expo will fit. That's the one I actually used as an example in the tutorial. But AllCon, no. And Anime Fest, definitely no.
It really depends, because it's like sometimes if you make the holder big enough, it'll fit.
Right. But then it's going to make all the smaller badges look really weird.
That's why you got to make multiples of them in different types of nerdy fabrics.
Also true. And in fact, I didn't show this in the tutorial, but if you wanted to, instead of using pre-made bias tape, if you make your own bias tape, you can actually make them reversible.
Yes.
So you can make bias tape using two different colors of fabric on each side and then just color coordinate so you have like one color facing out and then a different color on the back so you can always flip it around if you want to. You could do that with nerdy fabric too if you didn't want to just use solid colors. Mm-hmm. Use two different nerdy fabrics too, depending on how you feel that day. Maybe you feel like Super Mario, maybe you feel like Donkey Kong, who knows?
It seems like chat really appreciated it though, so thank you, Amber.
Indeed. We wanted to do something a little bit different for you guys because we know that, one, we have a lot of new listeners. So, hey guys, welcome.
Hi.
Please find a seat, grab some beverages, enjoy the show. But also because we're going to have to learn how to convention all over again.
We got to restart the convention button.
We have to learn how to human again at conventions.
What?
So, when you go back to conventions, it's kind of neat if you can have like nerdy gear to show off your nerddom. Mm-hmm. If you don't necessarily have a cosplay to wear, because casual cosplay is perfectly fine and good. In fact, some days it's actually preferable. First day of the con and the last day of the con is usually preferable to being casual cosplay, to be honest.
Or the entire weekend if it's really, really stinking hot outside.
Also true. Or very cold. So it's really cool to be able to show off your nerddom with things like nerdy lanyards, mm-hmm. nerdy badge holders, like little nerdy backpacks or fanny packs.
Exactly.
So we wanted to change it up a little. It's still cosplay in a way. It's still costuming. We're just accessorizing.
I have a very valid question that I think I actually have to Google for the answer on this one. Are we calling them fanny packs anymore?
Or actually.
Are we changing the name of them?
They are fanny packs. At least when I checked on them in the store week before last, they are still sold as fanny packs.
I've seen a couple of people call them belt bags to kind of get away from...
Also true.
Yeah, because fanny packs, it definitely sounds very dour old school, not like cool old school.
So, part of it also kind of depends on how you wear them, because fanny packs are more properly supposed to be worn with the bag on your back.
Right.
It doesn't necessarily have to, like, cover your fanny, but they're worn on your back so that you see the belt portion in the front.
Right.
But if you're doing the belt bag thing, those are typically worn in front of your body with the bag in front. So technically, you wouldn't even really call them fanny pack because you're not wearing them on your fanny.
Right.
So it's the same thing. I guess it's just a matter of how you wear it.
Okay. Well,
Wave Rod asks, what's a convention?
Man, I don't even know anymore. Let's be frank.
It's a gathering of a bunch of like-minded people to celebrate fandom. Yay.
Yay.
I'm telling you, we're going to basically have to restart the show when conventions start. We're going to have to do the whole how to pack for conventions.
Oh, man.
How to cook for conventions. How to do panels for conventions.
We're going to have content for the next 20 years easily.
I know. And if you guys did not know, we have actually covered all of these topics previously. In fact, some of them multiple times. If you go back and look in the show archives, we've covered like how to cook for cons, how to budget for cons, how to do all of those things for cons. But we're going to have to go back and watch our own content and learn how to do it all over again.
We got to push the restart button. Retrain ourselves.
Even for local cons, we're not even having to travel and do the whole... let's go through TSA with cosplay things. No, no, no. These are drivable distance 30 minutes away for us cons.
Oh, man. I don't know if I want to do out-of-state cons anymore, just thinking about TSA. Oh, man. That's always a pain in the rump.
We drove to GlitchCon.
We did.
Which is still out-of-state. So you can still kind of...
I could still drive.
At least in the United States and maybe in some parts of Europe, you can still drive... some distance and still go kind of out of your region for a con, but yeah, for the most part, if you fly, it's a bit hard.
It's the TSA war zone.
The TSA, for those who are not in the United States, are those lovely, friendly people in the airports who run security and have to look through all of your luggage and make sure you are not hiding illicit substances or lethal weapons on your body. And going through that process is kind of an ordeal at this point.
Even if you have priority access, it's still kind of a pain in the butt.
Yeah. For those who are experienced travelers, they kind of know the rigmarole by this point, and they kind of know how to speed up the process a little.
Yeah, you know exactly, like... like, which line, like, the moment that you're through that first section and you have to divvy yourself up through the security gates where they actually scan your body and all that, like, you can tell which line to go into that's the fastest. Like, I already know which ones to stand behind. Like, you see people with families? No, don't go in that line. You'll be in that line forever.
And they're wearing sweatpants so they don't have to take off their belts. They're wearing flip-flops because you have to take your shoes off. They've already got all of their electronics on the table. They've got all of their liquids apportioned out.
Yep.
Like, they know.
They know the deal, and you know that that's the best people to stand behind because it will go like that.
And do what they do.
Yes.
I've only flown twice since 9/11 and this whole thing started.
Seriously? Wow.
Because normally, whenever I travel, it's always a drivable distance. It's never a distance where I have to fly. But I went to out-of-state conventions where I had to fly twice. And the first time I went, was definitely a wake-up call, because all that TSA stuff didn't exist the last time that I flew before 9/11.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't know about the whole, you have to take off your shoes, you have to take off your belt, you have to lay out all of your liquids, and because I had makeup and everything, and I had a bunch of electronics, and it's...
Oh my. Wow.
It was an experience.
That sounds like it was an experience.
It still went quickly, because I knew where all my stuff was packed, but still. If I had had cosplay with me, I don't know what I would have done. Because I bring more makeup for cosplay.
Of course you do.
I bring, like, cosplay makeup.
Yeah.
So for those who even have theatrical things, it's probably even worse.
You just gotta know the process and you learn the tricks.
Or ship it. Just ship it to the hotel.
Or you find an airline that gives you one free checked bag and you know you can stick it in your checked luggage and you will be fine 99% of the time. It's about as good as shipping it.
Or heck, I'd find a local and say, if I purchase this, can I have it shipped to you? And can you bring it to me at the con? Here, I'll pay you for your trouble.
I don't trust shipping companies because they've lost so much crap
for
me
in the past.
That's
why I have a local.
I don't know.
They can pick it up.
Do not trust. Do not trust. Do we have anything else we need to cover?
No, ma'am. I believe that covers everything, unless, of course, you've got something for Nick Cage that you would like to bring up in terms of Halloween costumes.
Absolutely not. We got an after session to do.
All right, Potters. So, of course, if you would like to give your feedback on the tutorial you just saw, or if you would like to give your feedback on what it's going to feel like to get back into conventions once we eventually get there, please feel free to let us know on any of our social media, which, of course, you can find here.
Those who are watching us right now, visit all the information that's underneath Amber right over there in the corner. Whee! If you're listening to us, visit us at cospod.org, on Facebook or Instagram at Cosplay Podcast, or on YouTube and Twitter at cospodcast.
You can also email us, if you are so inclined, podcast@cospod.org, where you will get an answer from both of us, and possibly a Nick Cage meme.
Oh, I need to do that more often now. Oh, I have so many.
If you guys email us, we'll send you back a meme.
Yes. That's now a promise.
It'll be in our signature now. We're going to make a signature that has a Nick Cage meme in it.
Done.
Otherwise, please stay safe. Stay healthy out there as best as you can, guys. Please, we want to see you at the next convention locally ASAP. And for that, we need everybody healthy and happy. Keep working on those cosplays. We'll see you next time in episode 240. Happy cosplaying, everybody.
241. Bye.
I was thinking 241, and I was staring at the word 240, and that's why it came out that way.
See you in episode 241, everybody.